Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. For the reviews of Moses and Sims from Antigua. I'll just make this presentation. Mr. Chairman, if I take more time, please stop me because I have a lot of slides here. Normally, land is composed of two parts. We have the hardware and the software. The hardware is normally handled by the surveyors, and the software is handled by the lawyers, scientists, and other people. This study is on the software. So we made an adventurous venture into the software. And I hope that we're not going to run into serious problems for this traditional area where we do research. So this study was called Perspectival Action Research into issues that affect access to land and increase the security of tenure of the urban poor. And it was part of the wider study or the wider project about transforming settlements for the urban poor in Uganda. So we did it, it had various components that I'm just giving you work that we did for one of the components. If I have time, probably I'll maybe also giving you other components. But I have a report, a big report from the study, which contains results for the other aspects. If anyone is interested, you can give me your email, then I'll send you the entire report. So the problem, these are basic things in all land tenure, is very important aspect, most especially the security of the tenure. It is necessary to understand which rights are existed on which land so as to plan for some upgrade projects. Our project was mainly in the slum areas. Sometimes we call them slum areas and sometimes we call them informal settlements. But in the Ugandan context, we like to call them slums. I like to call them slums because most of our settlements, even those ones which you don't think are slums, are informal. And if you look at, say, residential areas like Niemba, that's an informal settlement. You may not call it a slum. So the problem is the manner in which they have a land, and the different arrangements, tenure arrangements, are not properly understood. And the lack of this knowledge has resulted, first of all, into tenure insecurity. We have examples of this, you know, the Asokoso, and other cases, actually, the slums. Then we also have the poor relations between landlords and tenants. Mr. Ward has talked about this multiple rights mainly on minor land. Then there is increased urban poverty and landlessness. Some years ago, whenever we talk about the poor, we refer to the rural poor. But now over time, we have realized that actually the urban poor are even poorer than the rural poor. Then unplanned settlements, and also unsuccessful slum upgrade projects. We've had projects that aim at upgrading some areas. These projects many times they fail or they don't attain the desired outcome. An example of this is the Namuongo. I think you know that project. That area was a slum area. And the purpose of upgrade was to uplift the standards of the people. But what happened later on is that actually when they upgraded it, the people moved further into the swamp, into more dangerous conditions, and then another set of people can do investment. And the reason probably is that prior to planning the upgrade, people do not understand these tenure rights and also the different tenure systems that existed. So the objectives we had, objectives of this study, which to address them to research questions. The first one was, what are the different land rights in informal settlements in Uganda? And how are the different rights acquired? What is the relationship between the landlord and tenants? What is the most effective way of formalizing land rights in informal settlements? So the study was focused on these research questions, and we got findings. So material and data we used mainly for data. It was mainly for data study, although we had some aspects for data. So we had these normal research methods, which you know. I'm not going to explain them because of time. And it was basically in five municipalities: Jinja Municipality, Mbarara, Kabare, and Arua. You know these municipalities, some of you live in Uganda. Jinja is in eastern Uganda with about 96,000 people. Mbarara is in southwestern Uganda with about 85,000 people. Kabare Municipality in eastern Uganda with about 92,000 people. Kabare Municipality, about 45,000 people, also in southwestern Uganda. So the sampling procedure of these projects, these municipalities were already under this super project transforming settlements for the urban poor, and there is an organization which had already gone there do some work. The organization is called SDI. They had already mobilized the inhabitants of the slums, so they already had the list of the slum dwellers. So we acquired the list from them, and we sorted the lists. We divided them into landlords and tenants, because we wanted to look at the various needs of the landlords and also the tenants. So we sampled 10% of the households in each of these slums. We had survey instruments, including questionnaires and interviews. So what we find, I will just summarize 10 of them. These are just statistics. 55% of the respondents were landlords, and 41 were tenants, and we had only 4% who were occupants on minor land, and these were mainly in Jinja. So in terms of the tenure systems, we found out that actually 51% of the land tenure in the urban slums was 51, it was the highest. Then this world and free world constituted 22% and 25%, and Mayo was only 2%. Mayo was 2% because we excluded Kampala, where we have actually put more Mayo. And many of you that know that Mayo tenure is mainly in the central region of Uganda, which we excluded from the study. So, about how different one land rights are acquired in the urban poor settlements. First of all, we found out. Maybe what I will do just to give you the presentation, because I have a lot of things which I will have discussed. So we found out that 66% of the land in the urban informal settlements is applied through purchase, 66%. Then inheritance is 26%. Gift and lease, 4% each. Then we ask the people why they chose to live in urban and the former settlements, and these were the responses, which range from presence of social services, work-related factors. Here, presence of social services, the former government came to the informal settlements originally being in the rural areas, and they were looking for better social services, and so they moved to cities, but they could not afford to live in organized settlements. Then, the relationships between landlords and tenants, largely they were very good. And we also asked them about why their relationships were good. We asked the landlords and the tenants, and this is running from prompt payment, good neighborliness, and so on. Then, regarding formalization of land rights in the informal settlements, we also looked at evidence of land ownership. What evidence the different people have that they own the land? 62% had a purchase agreement, then 15% had a will, 15% had land titles, and 8% had nothing. So we also try to get their opinion on the acceptable ways of formalizing land rights, and we found a number of opinions which are summarized here. So, the discussions, first of all, most of the land in informal settlements is held under customary tenure. The implication of this that some upgrade projects should not assume that urban councils are in full control of urban land, because most of the land is held by people. And of course, you know, we have been talking about customary land. Customary land is always encumbered by the customs, and it's not easy to access. Then we also found out the land in the five municipalities predominantly belong to the natives, who owned land prior to when the municipality was gazetted. So the original owners are increasingly subdividing the land and selling it to new owners. And there is no control on the subdivision. We used to actually need to see lots of 10 meters by 10 meters. And you know where a small house is built, that's a small plot. And there's no control on that. Then, also we found out that actually many of the people you see in the informal settlements do not own land there. Many of them are tenants. So if you target the landowners for some upgrade, then it means you are actually going to be helping a few people, and you are not helping the entire town. Then, security of tenure was a daily fear for a number of landowners and tenants in the informal settlements. Actually, every time these people are worried that their land is going to be taken. But who are they worried about? They are not worried about themselves. And we found out from the results that the biggest enemy they are fearing in the municipal council. The biggest enemy in the municipal council, and we learned that when the municipality wants to expand roads or wants to acquire land for other purposes, then the easiest target in the informal settlement, where they go, they acquire land, and they don't even own assets. So here, this means that it's important actually to secure the land rights of the informal settlements. And we can look at PROPUA, fit for purpose land rights recording tools, which can help to secure the land rights. Then finally, the recommendations, such as 1 minute. We have seen that government should simplify the procedure and cost of formalizing land ownership rights in informal settlements. And this would be an incentive for the poor land owners to register their land. And I've already talked about this low cost, fit for purpose tool that we did. Then we also, from the various discussions, we also suggest that this process should be done in an incremental manner, and we also will propose the steps that will be utilized. These are about 6 steps, which I have listed here. Thank you. Of course, I've left most of the thing because of that.